So, after seeing that video clip, I was really interested to hear if you've got any experience with A&R companies, and when you first start making music, and you start getting some interest in your music, what happens next? What happened with your music?
Well, what happens with my music, you see, the thing is, when you work with a record company, and they're taking care of everything for you, you don't really have to think anything. So, what it is, after leaving the band, after 7 years touring the world and winning a BPI award, like it's a British Performance Industry.
Okay.
So it's like awards, you know. So basically, you've got to then, for me, I had to learn about the coding your record, your music, and now when we was performing, we was actually the internet wasn't really existing as such.
Okay.
So if the internet was around when we was performing, maybe we'd have been a lot more. We was bigger. I mean, we was a big cult following band. I mean, the thing is, we should have been millionaires, and I suppose we made loads of money, but there's, you know, a lot of people to be paid, and the record company take back whatever money.
Was it a certain record label that you released?
Yeah, it was. The record label was called Talking Loud. Is it Bright?
Mm-hmm. That's what I'm looking for.
Right, press the.
That's it.
Turn it on.
That's
it.
It's
Bright.
It.
Right? Yeah, so.
What
it is.
Is Talking Loud a UK?
Yeah, it's a UK label. What it is, you had Giles Peterson, that was the A&R for Galliano.
Okay.
So he's the one that actually signed Galliano from the beginning.
Okay, and how did they find you? How does A&R work?
Well,
how does someone find out about other people making music?
Well,
that's what I want to know, basically.
Yeah, well, the thing is, I mean, for me, it's like, it all starts about the nightclubs. You go to it's all about the nightclub. It's all about the scene. Yeah, it's that's how it started for me, and that's how, in most cases, that's how it starts. Sometimes you may meet people just out of meeting people, and it's a form of network. But definitely, you meet people on the scene, networking, and the next minute, these people say, "No, they're doing this." It could be television, it could be music, you know, it could be acting, it could be some form of documentary. You see what I mean? And for me, it was music. And so what it is, I met certain people from the band that...
Were they already formed? Was Galliano already formed as a band before you met them? Or were people coming together from different backgrounds?
Yeah, it was like actually starting to come together. Like, when I actually got introduced to Galliano, there was a formation going on.
Okay.
But it wasn't complete. So I feel that by me getting involved in Galliano and playing a role, that's when I felt that it was more complete, because sometimes you need a showman. It's like nowadays, it's like years back, you see Stylistics or Motown or whatever, you're doing all these different things, and then you see people dance in a certain way. And now you have more choreographers that actually dance for the artists.
Okay.
The artist doing it as much. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So,
were you doing that as well? Were you dancing?
Well, yeah.
In your music videos, I'm imagining there were music videos. Were there music videos?
Yes, there was. Yes. I don't think. Yeah, I danced in the music videos. Yeah, I was called a vibes controller. So,
what's the vibes controller mean?
It just means someone controlling the vibe and like the audience, basically. So, by the reaction of what I was doing as the vibes controller, what it is, I was like the last person that was introduced to the stage, and every time I hit the stage, it was like an electrifying, it was like an electricity that's, you know, someone put in the plug and then everything blasts off. So that was
so
like...
Have you got a clip, maybe, that we could see performance?
The thing is, I have clips.
Yeah.
I don't know that exact clip where, you know, people
but I
have clips where... Like, for example, we was at the Forum in Kentish Town, and one of the songs was called Prince of Peace, and I abseiled 80 feet down on the stage, in my kilt.
That sounds crazy.
yeah, it was really mad. And basically, at the end of the gig, there was like a stage invasion,
Sure.
Yeah, where
people climbing up.
Yeah, they just completely went absolutely bananas.
Yeah.
So what sort of phase of time from getting involved in music and getting together with the band? How long did it take you before you were starting to travel and go to other places because of the music?
Well, I mean, the thing is, sometimes for some people it may take them years, but what it is, like when people see a band, sometimes they may not realize that a specific person, it may have taken a long time to get there.
Of course.
So what it is, by this person getting the actual, these specific people to play a part, a role in the band, then it creates that thing. Do you see what I mean?
Whatever that magical element is that gets everybody
That's right. So if you've got a good band that are very good players, that makes whatever the singer, the rappers, or whatever that is doing their thing, then it makes it more of a concrete thing to do. Mm. Yeah.
Well, I'm thinking what we're going to do is maybe just get a clip play.
Sure, sure.
And you can tell us a little bit about the clip, when it was.
Yeah, I could do that, yeah. That should be a problem. There's quite a few on there, so I'd have to sift through to find that which one is which.
So when did you first start making music?
Well, I started making music in 1995. That's after putting my fingers up to the band and had enough of them. And, well, the thing is, I was actually making music before. I don't know if, let me see if I can move this forward.
Yeah, just.
In 1995, it was, I met a friend called Ishii from Japan, and there was about a project going on in Japan, and he says, can I do it? So I went out there and I took a drum right over me and just done some stuff. Yeah, so, you know.
Japanese jazz band.
Yeah.
So. Are the Japanese really into jazz?
Yeah, they're into all sorts, yeah. Definitely got the right soul.
Kind of music my granddad listens to.
Is it?
Yeah. I actually like it as well.
I like jazz too.
It's
just got a good vibe to it.
Yeah.
I think the CD's
gone.
DVD,
right, okay. Yeah, so let me see.
Yeah, see what else you have to show us.
Let me see what else. Let me go to Prince of Peace, who I was telling you about. Yeah, Prince of Peace. This was at the Forum.
The time has come when we may run. We've got to get it out so we can get around the world strong and truly beloved. To erase or equal the Creator will never need a sequel. To be asked for all to join us in the universe of prayer, every man.
That's the big one.
Silence.
Noise for violence, sick another way. More than missiles need guidance. Peace is the way that we're gonna survive. The choice is now, or being alive. The leaders have no answer, see they're just as confused.
Rapping in the rhythm, but the rhythm's been used.
Thoughts need an amplifier for them to get higher. Become a producer instead of just a buyer. I call a grand nation,
a meeting of the people.
Well, if it don't drop, well then we call a sequel. Thoughts swing down, so I make a compilation. It's a universal label and it's used for this occasion. You say we're dreamers,
we're not the only one. I'd rather have a dream than a nightmare to come.
Mainstream hip hop is what the UK call underground. It's still there, but in the UK it's underground.
It
deliberately hasn't hit mainstream.
Well, yeah, I think it will always be sort of like underground. Hip hop is not like hip hop as it used to be. Hip hop has become more R&B. I've never really, in the early days of hip hop, I didn't really like hip hop. I was coming from more like reggae and more sort of like. I was more from the reggae and I got more into soul music. And then when I got into the hip-hop, I saw like mass crowd of people in Piccadilly Circus thinking, man, this looks really interesting. But at the time, I found hip-hop kind of like that dry sort of element of the style of it. But years later, when it started becoming more R&B mixed with that hip-hop flavour, then I grasp it more because it had the more, as they say, rhythm and blues, or the, do you know what I mean? That sort of the blend. So that's what got me more into hip hop, personally.
And do you think, as far as the lyrics go,
yeah.
you know, like you, sort of the UK versus the US at that time, there was sort of a big difference in the lyrics. Like you were saying, there's some heavy sounding lyrics. I don't know, do you think that's still true now?
Music is diverse, you know, it's like you say, you know, and NWA times, so to speak, they were just rapping about the street way of life, and then
cool.
just exploded from there.
Good hip hop,
so,
again,
you know.
Right.
And
yeah, it was fantastic, yeah.
And then the Grandmaster Flash time in
yes.
the days,
yes.
so it's just, you know, it's like.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you mentioned some like great people, you got Public Enemy, and
yeah.
you got. What you call it? What's the name? Method Man.
KRS-One. Yeah.
Yeah. So you know, there was like, so when I saw elements of people like these guys, that's like, man, this is like really interesting. I'm like, yeah, I'm liking it because like you can feel the energy, you know.
And that's just before here. I mean, that's pre-90s stuff, right? I mean, somebody tell me because I don't know my hip hop very well.
Well, the thing is, I mean, it was sort of like, you can say. 80s coming up to the 90s, etc. But you know, what was the point again? Sorry,
well, I was just saying it seems like there's this divide in lyrics where the UK seems like there's some more sort of positive sounding lyrics to really, you know, my basic ears, and in the US it sounds a bit harder and heavier.
Yeah, this is called Earth Boots. Yeah, this went down a real treat on tour as well. Yeah, so this is
the
word.
What genre of music would you call it though, Mike? I mean, I don't know if I heard it, I don't know what I'd call it. Like,
well,
jazz or sort of kind of funk.
Well,
that's
I mean,
when I think jazz or funk, but
I mean, the thing is, sorry about the old crazy light. The thing is, it's like they called it poetry rap.
Poetry rap.
Yeah, I mean that's.
Is there a genre called poetry rap? Me and Lena, and basically our job is to show
your name?
Film Claire? About Claire Spencer.
Claire Spencer.
Film
and your name?
About London and about
Lena.
The culture.
Your
sort of
Lena.
Society. Lena, right? Okay. Cool.
Of it. So if you want to see anything in the collection, we can get you access to
London
it.
London Screen Study.
London Screen Study Collection.
There
is an email you can email out if there's something you want to see or you want to ask if we've got it, so you can.
We show films Wednesday evenings.
The good point. Sorry,
well,
my brain's
it's far
like
from here, but it's, you know, it's Stratford Picture House, which is in Stratford. But it's 8:30 every Wednesday evening.
Yeah.
We show different films.
There's a screening series.
They're
there.
On their website. You can go to their website
and
see.
And there's a series that. Birkbeck in Bloomsbury that's free, and that's on Tuesdays at
2:30,
and that's
Birkbeck University.
You just walk in and I'll be there,
that's
or Lena will be there going.
That's like whole,
I know, it's a long way.
Educate people through his lyrics in England.
Yeah.
You know, you have so many politicians, people jumping on the back, he should be saying this and he should be saying so people, you know, who want to put him down, the same people that want to talk about free speech in other countries. So it's hypocrisy, it's politics, and everything else.
It could be to do with that sometimes when an artist has a really strong message in some way, sometimes they can become almost too powerful in their own culture because they can put out a message more fluently than maybe the government or other forms of society. So in effect they are, I mean, it's not a conspiracy theory, it seems that this happens in some cases, then that person's channels to be able to communicate things are drawn in.
Of course, a lot of older people, their generation, how they dress, how they speak, what they speak about, doesn't resonate with younger people. So if you have an artist who comes out now, who working class, he knows what's going on, ground level, and he starts speaking, it resonates straight away because he's speaking the same language, he can communicate,
the majority
they understand.
Is actually speaking.
But someone who's, you know, who's wearing a suit and they're talking about 50 years ago, they're talking about what they know, and they want it to resonate now. It's a whole different era, it's a whole different culture.
Yeah,
it's not relevant.
Yeah,
You know what I mean? Where if you're young, black, working class, you live in a certain area, and you don't have many prospects, and people already pigeonholed you, a white Etonian politician, you know, who's born with a silver spoon in his mouth and speaks a certain way.
He's not going to relate.
There's such
in
a divide.
There's
no communication. You need an interpreter.
It's really interesting that you say that. Can I interrupt for just 1 second? I think Naz, I don't know how much of that clip we got to see. Maybe we can watch some more of it.
Sure, yeah.
Naz, when he's maybe 20, I was pretty stunned by his awareness, even though he's coming from this quite intense place of growing up in a project. And I think part of the reason why is his father studied to play the horn. He's a classical musician. But what he's saying, it's almost, for me, from my point of view anyways, I have to listen really carefully to what he's talking about. And he's talking about what you're talking about culture, about society, and what is and isn't allowed. And he's talking about that in the context of music. And he's a 20-year-old man. He's quite young. His awareness is pretty profound. It's interesting to see him go on in his career and his sort of politics unfold and some of the messages he says in his music, which, I mean, for me, I think some of them are quite beautiful, talking about equality and about sort of, I know it sounds naive, but a greater good in a way, which I think a lot of, you know, I think a lot of artists in the end maybe opt for money and let that part sort of dissipate. So I don't know, I like him for that, but sorry to...
Yeah, you said something about keeping a divide between how people see each other, and it's quite ironic you say that, because it's going off into music, not into music, it's more into the, like, social TV on this.
Yeah.
The latest I'm a Celebrity has shown that there's a member of Parliament, I believe, that has actually gone in on this, and she has got in a lot of trouble with the rest of Parliament, because she's missing two meetings, but on for a social level, people are actually going to more likely to listen to her, because she's like, they're like, we've actually got a member of Parliament, which, as we like say, is they've got a silver spoon stuck in their mouth that they want from day one. She's come down to the same level as a lot of other celebrities. They see member of Parliament, think they're at a whole other level. They're coming to the same level as celebrities. It's still higher than normal social class, but it's at a level that we can associate with. And through that, it's quite ironic, because now they listen to him, but... if I'm rightly reading the newspaper, they say something about they've got to go and she's got to have a meeting with the head of her boss.
Right.
As soon as she comes back, which will probably mean that she has to give a formal apology. And that's what it usually is. But I've got to give her an apology for trying to do something different, trying to show that what she says might work.
That's a really interesting point.
If you
point.
Do that in America, well, one, not many people would actually care.
I think that's true too.
Yeah.
But you know what to do with the lyrical content. England has influenced America in a lot of ways to do with the music. I've witnessed it for a fact. Sorry?
It's both ways around.
Oh yeah, nice. No, but it's a two-way thing. But like, America has got a lot of influence from the British culture of music. I've seen it. I mean, it's just like Gangstar, for example. It's just like the British artists, where we done music in a certain way, and we gave it back to America. And I remember Gangstar, we used to hang out with Gangstar, Guru. And I remember he was asking us, hey, where you guys get your music from? So we told him Reckless Records.
Okay.
Was it Reckless? Yeah, was it Reckless Records? Yeah. And like, basically, it's by chance that... I think we went back to the West End that same week, and we saw the whole of America going into Reckless Records to buy out the whole of the old school stuff. And what was that Blue Note album that he came out with? Oh man, it was a very popular one. I can't remember the name, but anyway, basically, they got influenced by a lot of stuff we've done, so, you know. I think All That Jazz, that's it, All That Jazz album.
So do you guys think it flows both ways, US to UK and vice versa? Or do you think it's a bit tighter than that, it's a bit more restricted like you were saying?
I think personally the UK will have faces when they will influence.
Oh, definitely.
You know, but obviously America has the majority share, as usual.
Sure, because the landmass size, the number of people.
Just the industry.
The industry in general, yeah.
And, you know, the big corporation, the, you know, where the money is. If you have that, the foundation, basically you control the stage. And although you have, I mean, these are both English-speaking countries.
Yeah.
So we're going to influence each other. And most of the rest of the world, although they're now having their own artists start to come through, they've been following the UK, US examples of dress.
Western culture.
Yeah, Western culture. You know, they watch our films, they watch the way we dress, how we dance. And it's a genre as well. I mean, a lot of this has come from the Second World War, where the US, UK, Soviets had divided up, you know, the countries that got destroyed and dominated, and tried to remake them in our image. So they're still being influenced by us, but they're making a great bridges. Japan, Korea, China.
It's not always though, if you look at it, this is more into the sort of music I listen to, which is punk metal and post-hardcore. It's quite ironic when you listen to stuff. If you look at the locations of where the artists come from, it is usually UK, Japan and Europe. And I say UK separately, because we seem to be always coming up as well.
They didn't let him in because they're readily made. With violent connotations in there, however...
Bust run.
No, not Bust
Run. You're talking way before.
Boom, bam, bam.
Educate me.
It's a reggae tune, and it's singing, you know, shoot a certain type of person. However, for years you hear in the States all the gangster rap.
Yeah.
You know, I've got my Glock, I've got the Desert Eagle,
yeah.
I'm letting go.
So that doesn't really make sense, does it?
Yeah.